Hold on.
If they were more, we're going to give a G7 and go right into the C7.
Okay.
So make sure you're singing G7.
I will. I can hit G7. That's, you got to tighten up your britches.
Do what you got to do.
Let's play over live on that. It's close to this.
Oh. Make sure I'm way too loud.
Oh, yeah.
Ready?
Yep.
Sing the first verse and then move around, make somebody around you feel welcome.
Blood. seated. Good to see you all. God bless you. Welcome, welcome, welcome to worship, worship, worship at Oak Grove Baptist Church. Hey, in your bulletin, if you got one, down in the lower right-hand corner of the page that's on the right as you open it up is our schedule for the fall, which begins next month. The different dates are there. I won't be a parrot and read all that to you. But if you're interested, especially in our Sunday night disciple school, I need you to let me know so I can get you one of our booklets. We'll be using this fantastic booklet. We used this in our men's group 4 or 5 years ago. It's 30 discipleship exercises. It's from the Billy Graham Evangelistic Association. And it's just a fantastic little booklet. But I need to know how many are coming. So if you'd like to come, that's Sunday nights at 6, beginning on September the 8th. That's the week after Labor Day. Send me a text or call me or talk to me or whatever, and I'll make sure you get one of these. It's basic discipleship. But if you have already gone through some basic discipleship, this would be a good review, or it may be a good opportunity for you to bring a younger believer with you and kind of mentor them. You know, we have two kind of peoples in our lives, mentors and tormentors. So be a mentor and not a tormentor. And this is a fantastic experience. Half of it we'll do this fall and half of it we'll do in the spring. But that's on Sunday nights at 6 o'clock. So if you'd like to be involved in that, let me know so I can get you a book. And then the other various activities are mentioned there as well. So be looking at that and be praying about that, how God can plug you into what we got going on as far as the whole disciple-making enterprise is concerned. Father, what a joy it is to be with you today, to be with your people as we look forward to school, getting back into session and moving away from the summertime schedule and the school schedule. We just pray for our schools. We pray for our teachers and our young people, children, as they go back to school. We just pray, God, that you would bless them and make this a fruitful year for them as they grow in their understanding of who they are and who you've called them to be. Help us as a church to reach young people, to have opportunities for them to study your word and get to know you and experience life as you've designed it. Pray for each of us that we would be on the lookout for people that we can reach and we can help to grow. Help us to be intentional and relational. Help us to be sensitive to your Holy Spirit and communicating your truth. And Father, we just thank you so much for the salvation that we have through Jesus Christ. And we ask this in his name. Amen.
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 Holy, holy. try something. We'll see. Sails are torn. till I have fallen on my knees as I face the raging seas. The anchor holds in spite of the storm. Of the
storm. If you have your Bible, I invite you to find the Gospel of Matthew. Last week, if you were with us, we began looking at the greatest message you'll ever hear. And the greatest message you'll ever hear is commonly called the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7. It's the greatest message you'll ever hear because it's preached by the greatest person that ever lived, Jesus Christ. It's the greatest message you'll ever hear because its subject is the greatest subject in the Bible. That's the kingdom of heaven. And it's the greatest message you'll ever hear because its purpose is the greatest purpose known to man. And that's how to live a life that pleases God. So it's the Sermon on the Mount preached by the King, Jesus, about the principles and the practicals of his kingdom, how to enter it, how to experience it, and how to express it to others who need to know the King, who is the King of the kingdom that's coming. Soon and very soon, the old song says by Andre Crouch and the disciples, soon and very soon, we're going to see the King, hallelujah, hallelujah. We're going to see the King. We've sung that here many times. So in Matthew 5, he commences this greatest message you'll ever hear with kingdom attitudes. Attitudes, how we think, mindset, viewpoint, perspective. And the attitude or the mindset of kingdom people is different than the kingdoms of this world. We have a different attitude, a different approach to how we live. And Jesus lays those attitudes out as he begins this message in chapter 5. In chapter 6, he shifts to the actions of a kingdom disciple. That's not just what we think, but what we do, our decisions, our choices, some of these strategic decisions that we make at various junctures in our lives that keep us following Christ and not getting off on the detours of lesser battles and other things that don't make a difference from the perspective of eternity. And then in chapter 7, he concludes this message with kingdom authority. And kingdom authority is who we are. It's our identity in Christ. It's the reality that we're, in a sense, dual citizens. We live in this world, but as Paul said, we're not of this world. And so we are called by Christ, according to this constitution of his kingdom, to think different and to do different and to be different and to demonstrate that we belong to another kingdom. Now, these kingdom attitudes in chapter 5 are prefaced by this word blessed there in beginning in verse 3 and on through verse 11 and 12. The idea of being blessed, the Latin is beatitudes, and some Bibles will even have this separated with what they call the beatitudes. And at beatitudes is just Latin for blessed. The Greek term is makarios, which means happy. So in the Greek language, there's no distinction between being blessed and being happy. And I'd say one great way to be happy is be blessed. And we are greatly blessed, and that's our source of happiness. Again, sometimes in the world, we can get off on things we think are going to make us happy, but they don't. They never satisfy us deeply and richly And faithfully, they let us down, things in this world, people in this world, situations in this world. So as we keep our minds set on Christ and his kingdom, and we make decisions and choices consistently that are in cooperation with his kingdom, and then we live in that authority that we're forgiven, and we have a message to share with everybody we come into contact with. There's good news. Jesus has died for our sins, and he's coming again, and there's something to live for that's beyond a paycheck or beyond the more mundane things in this life that sometimes we can set our hopes on and hook our star to, but then again let us down. So chapter 5, verse 3, we looked at it last week. It shows us how to enter the kingdom. We're not born into the kingdom of God. We're born into the kingdom of this world. We've got to be born again. The Bible tells us we need a relationship with Jesus Christ, which comes through an experience of understanding our need and turning to him. So he says here in verse 3, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The word poor there, it's literally the word we get beggar from. We're totally bankrupt when it comes to righteousness, holiness, right standing when trying to stand next to a holy and righteous God. So we have to come to the point in our everyday living and experience where we say, yes, I am a sinner. Yes, I have sin. Yes, I am undone. Yes, I have a need. And I admit that. I stop trying to be better, do better, get better. I stop trying to join every church in town or trying to live up to the Ten Commandments or do goodism. And I realize that's not it. Because when do I know? When do I know if my good enough is good enough? I never know for sure. And I'm fraught with all sorts of emotional trauma, difficulties. I thought I did it. Did I do it? Did I cross every T? Did I dot every I? I don't know. And God says, that's not it. You've got to admit your need and then believe in Jesus who died on the cross fully, finally, totally, eternally, paying our sin debt. Yours, mine, and ours. Can't pay any more than that. And we say yes to him and we accept him. And at that point, We get a transplant. His righteousness for our sin. That's a pretty good transplant. His bank account, his abundance for our bankruptcy. It's a pretty good transfer, pretty good exchange. And all the righteousness of Jesus Christ, which is all the righteousness there is imputed. That's the theological term, to us. Can't earn it. Don't deserve it. And yet God gives it as a free gift through the blood of his son. And that's what we call salvation. That's why it's good news. Somebody said it's so good it can't be true. I said it's so good it's got to be true. And so we believe by faith in Jesus. And at that point, we move from the kingdom of this world, kingdom of sin, kingdom of Satan, kingdom of hell. And we moved into the kingdom of salvation, the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven. Praise the Lord for that. I had an interesting experience many years ago that illustrates this point. I was pastoring a small church in Central Florida, and occasionally I'd get a telephone call from the funeral home, local funeral home, and I would go to the National Cemetery. There's a very large national cemetery there in Sumter County, Florida. And so veterans, a lot of veterans, of course, retire, and their spouses as well, and they're both given burial in the National Cemetery. So from Jacksonville, Pensacola, all the way down to Miami, they would drive to this central location. And so they have a lot of what they call committal ceremonies there for veterans. And occasionally I get a telephone call to officiate one of these. And so I would drive to the National Cemetery and await this family. Well, this one was coming, and it was the smallest funeral I've ever done, two people. And the hearse drove up, come down from around Miami, as I recall, Coral Gables, I believe. And the hearse pulled up with the casket in the back and one car behind it. And a man a little bit older than myself at the time, probably in his 50s. And aging lady, the wife of the deceased, the veteran. And they got out and I met them for the first time and was going to do the best I could to bring some comfort and hope and help this family who had driven all this way to this place they didn't know to bury this one they loved so much. And that's when I was told the story. It's an interesting story. The son told me about this gentleman. He was born in Finland. And so when World War II broke out, he was in a unique geopolitical, geo-citizen situation. He could have fought in the war for Finland, or he could have fought in the war for the United States. And through the process, and his son described it to me as his mother had described it to him, how he had grappled with who to fight for in the big war, the war, World War II. And so he made the decision to become a citizen at that time of the United States and to fight for us in the war. Well, that's what happens with us. When we're confronted with the fact that we have these two kingdoms in our heart, these two things that are colliding and wanting our attention, we have to make a decision at some point. Who am I going to fight for? Who am I going to live for? The kingdom I was born into, which is all wrong, or the kingdom where I've become accustomed to wanting to go, the kingdom of heaven? And so that's what Matthew 5:3 is all about. It's all about the fact that we who are poor in spirit, born in the wrong kingdom, can make a choice to become part of God's kingdom. He calls it there in verse 3, the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who are beggars in spirit. Unto them come all the riches in heaven. Somebody said evangelism is just one beggar telling another beggar where the bread is. So listen to me. I'm just one beggar telling a bunch of other beggars Jesus is where the bread is. He's where salvation is. He's where hope and life and love is. And you come to him by faith and say yes. And he says, my. That's where it begins. That's how we enter the kingdom. All right, verse 4. The second beatitude, I'm calling this morning the blessing nobody wants. He says, blessed are those who mourn. They shall be comforted. Blessing and mourning. What a strange pair to put together. And yet we're reminded that Jesus' kingdom is different than the kingdoms of this world. It's almost upside down, isn't it? If you want to be great, then be the least. If you want to be first, be last. If you want to be master, serve. You want to get up, you got to go down. It makes no sense until you know the King and you begin to understand the way he operates his kingdom within the kingdom of this world. So blessed mourning. We would call that an oxymoron grammatically. You know, that's one of those two words put together that don't make sense. Oxymoron, like bittersweet or freezer burn or friendly argument. Jumbo shrimp, that's a good one. Original copy, awful good. Military intelligence, Microsoft Works. You know, there's all kinds of oxymorons. And this is one of them that wouldn't make sense to a person who doesn't know the King. I got to keep saying that. That's the key concept. Jesus is speaking here, verse 1 and 2, to people who are assembled, and he's telling them how it operates when you walk with me, as opposed to other voices in the world. So, blessed mourning, the blessing nobody wants. We experience this thing called mourning in several areas in life. Let me share those with you. They're broad areas. One is sin. We mourn because of sin. Sometimes we sin. And there's guilt and there's shame. There's regret. Sometimes we hurt people. Sometimes we hurt people we love because we sin. We break God's law and it breaks us. And the disobedience brings mourning. We hang our heads in shame because sometimes we do things we can't believe we did. Sometimes we don't do things we know we should have done. And it brings a deep sense of lack. I couldn't do it. I thought I could, but I didn't. I knew I should, but I didn't. And so we had this sense of mourning over sin. Number two, there's suffering. That's a broad category of difficulties in life. We suffer many things, sometimes because of sin, sometimes not. Sometimes it's our fault. Sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's somebody else's fault. Sometimes we don't know whose fault it is. But it still hurts. And it still breaks our heart. And we find ourselves with some gnawing in the middle of the night when we're alone, feeling of mourning about that. It didn't turn out like I thought. And here I am left in the shattered remnants of it, trying to figure out how to put it all back together. And we mourn over that. You know, lost opportunities or things we should have said or done that we didn't again, and now it's too late and the time's not right, and beat ourselves up, and some of our guilt is true and some of our guilt is false. And we mourn. And then the third area, a major area, is separation, and that's death. We think of this word mourning quite a bit when we think of people we love who are no longer with us, and we think about them sometimes, and the separation and the longing brings a mourning, and it's a process, and I'll talk about that more in a minute. But each of us, all of us at certain times, to one degree or another, experience mourning because of these various issues in life, heartache, heartbreak, pain, guilt, loss. Happens to everybody. Those who know God and those who don't. Jesus doesn't, you know, have any fine print here that exonerates a Christian, a believer, to live a life without burdens or troubles or problems. But he does say here that as we mourn, blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. And that's the key concept. The word there, same word he uses in the upper room with the disciples right before he went to the cross when he says, I'm going away, but I'm going to send somebody back to be with you, in you forever, the comforter, the counselor, the Holy Spirit. This word is sometimes translated that, comfort. It's sometimes translated counselor, sometimes encouragement. So it's the idea that even though we do mourn, we do have situations that cause us all sorts of heartache and heartbreak, there is a promise to God's people of comfort from him. How does he do that? Well, three or four ways. Write these down. Number one, his presence. God promises to what? Never leave us or forsake us. Now, he's always with us, those of us who know him. He's always here. But have you noticed when you hurt, it seems like he's closer? David did. Yea, though I walk to the valley, the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil. Why? Thou art with me. With me. And so it's almost like, you know, we get in our own lives and we're running our thing and going to the job, and we sometimes, God's right there, all, and he's there, but we don't really, and then we get hurt, or we hurt somebody, or something shocking happens, and we just don't know what to do. And then here he comes. I'm here, my child, I'm here. It's okay, I'm gonna be all right. In his presence, we just feel it more sometimes when we're hurting and we're struggling. And then his word, the second way he comforts us is through his word. Many times I've been searching and trying to figure things out and trying to work through some issues, and I'll read the Bible and there it is, right? It's happened to you too, hasn't it? Why is this happening to me? Or why can't I make sense out of this? And I've tried to figure it out when I should be faithing it out. And I go in the word and I'm reading and I'm searching, and the Lord raises something up there in his word, and then prayer. I'm praying to him. We're talking back and forth. And a lot of times when I'm mourning, when I'm going through some deep, abysmal something, I go to the Psalms. And many times people call me, Brother Rob, what am I going to do about this? And we'll go to the Psalms together. Because David and other psalmists, they're just crying out. It's just coming from the gut. They're just crying out, God, where are you? What am I going to do about this? I don't know what. And the answer comes. And then, of course, there's people, his church especially. But remember, I say this a lot. God puts people in your life, but you got to find out who those people are. And the traumatizing and the isolating thing about pain and issues is we want to isolate, don't we? It's hard for us to reach out. Why is it the first time we start going through all kinds of difficulties, we stop going to church? Why is that? Well, Satan's attacking. He's trying to get you to back off. When God has placed in his church, his people, what you need. Somebody's been through that before. You're not the only one. Probably. You feel like it. Obviously, me too. But God puts us in a context, a community of faith, where we're all going up the mountain together. We're working through it together. And that's a great source of comfort for me to realize I'm not all by myself, even though sometimes it may seem like that. And then a fourth thing that God uses to comfort us is just what I call circumstances. You may have a story. I've heard many of them. One time I was right over here at DuCoin at the cemetery meeting a family I'd never met before to officiate a funeral for the funeral home over there in DuCoin. They'd call me. And they asked me to bring my guitar, so I went over there and did a couple songs and read some scripture and tried to comfort this family who I'd never seen before and who I've never seen since. In fact, as I'm telling this story, I'm ashamed, but I don't even remember their name right now. Hundreds and hundreds of funerals, they all run together after 40 years. But I told them that they were going to make it, but there was a reason to go on, that God is good. He's got a plan. Those things that sometimes sound sort of bumper stickerish, but they're really true. They're really true. And so they were leaving, they were getting in their cars. I was kind of standing there with it all dripping off of me, wondering if I'd done any good. Sometimes I wonder a lot about that, but I trust God can use whatever I do more than I can do it. And an elderly lady came up to me. Again, I've never seen her before. I've never seen her since. She was a friend of the family, and she told me this story and encouraged me greatly that day. She said, "Preacher, everything you said is true. And I'm a living testament." And she told me the story of a day when she was standing at a similar place in another city in our state, alone. Her husband had died after 60 plus years of marriage, and she was gathered around the casket with her kids, and they were trying to get her to leave. And she said, "I was paralyzed. I couldn't leave. I couldn't leave him." She said, "He did everything for me." She said, "I didn't even drive. Never learned to drive." She went through everything he did, the bills and the driving and the grocery shopping, all this kind of stuff. And she said, "I didn't know how I was going to go on." And my kids were saying, "Come on, Mom, let's go." And then she stopped and she said, "Do you notice my butterfly pin?" Well, she had this gaudy looking butterfly pin on, you know, it had all kinds of jeweled colors on the butterfly wings. And she said, "I love butterflies. I've always loved butterflies." She said, "If you went to my house, there's butterflies all over my house." And she said, "That day, as I was standing there at the casket," she said, "and my kids was trying to get me to leave, and I wasn't leaving. I didn't know what to do. I didn't know how it was going to go on." She said, "A little butterfly flew right on my shoulder." And she said, "One of my kids went, because they all knew." And she said, "When that little butterfly sat on my shoulder, preacher, I knew I was going to make it." Now, isn't that weird? But that's unique circumstances. Sometimes God will speak to you in a way that only you can understand. But you'll hear it, and you'll know it, and you'll go on. So there's different ways that God helps us when we are low, when we're down, when we're confused, to give us strength, to give us comfort. It's all around us, all the time. But we have to access it. And that's the most important part of this message that I want to share with you this morning. Everyone experiences losses in life. Hey, the shortest verse in the Bible, what's it say? Even Jesus wept, right? And so every one of us will experience these this mind-numbing, excruciating, hope-crushing losses in life at times. But God promises to comfort us when we do. You see, it's the blessing nobody wants, but it's the blessing everybody needs. And so God promises to provide it. How do we access it? Well, look at the verse with me, and I'm almost done. Thank you for your patience. The Bible says, blessed are those who mourn. Now, I looked at 11 or 12 different English translations, and to my joy, every one of them said, blessed are those who mourn. Notice it doesn't say, blessed are those who are sad. It doesn't say, blessed are those who sorrow. It doesn't say, blessed are those who are depressed. It doesn't even say, and here's the key concept this morning, blessed are those who grieve. But it says, blessed are those who mourn. And so to access the comfort, the encouragement, the strength to go on when you mourn, as you mourn, you need to understand a very important little detail in your spiritual composition. That's the difference between grieving and mourning. They're different. This word mourn is the deepest, strongest, most intense word to describe this condition in the Greek language. And in Hebrew, it means to lament. We even have a book called Lamentations. Nobody ever goes to Lamentations to read for their quiet time. It's a sad book. It's a sorrowful book. It's a groaning book. So grief and mourning, if you're taking notes, write this down. This is so important. You may not need it today, but the next time you're in a hole, pull this out of your Bible. It'll help you get out. This is a tool for tough times. And they're coming in all of our lives. But when they come, God says, I'm with you. I'm going to comfort you. I'm going to bring you out. So grief is an emotion that God gives us to express loss. When I lose something that is valuable to me, whatever that is, I grieve. It's gone. I had attached something to that something or someone, whether it was appropriate or inappropriate, I had attached meaning and value to that, and now it's gone, and I grieve that. Listen, you can grieve a passion in life. Some people like to do certain things, and they love that. But then they get to an age where they can't do it anymore, or a stage of life where they can't do it, and they get down. That's a normal thing. Sometimes it's a position in life you can grieve. Sometimes when guys retire, they have difficulty because so much of their value is identified with their job. And they're looking forward to retirement, but then they retire like, now what am I going to do? Who am I? And there's a grieving that goes along with that. You feel that loss. Possessions, obviously. See these people out in California, their house is burned down in one of these wildfires, and they come back and they're just stunned. What do I do? It's gone. Well, they're grieving the loss of possessions. They're material. They will say things like, well, nobody died. This can be replaced. True, but still it's valuable to them. Hey, you can even grieve a pet, can't you? And we do. But the biggest grief is a person, obviously. So when anything that we have attached value to is gone, we grieve that loss. That's grieving. Are you with me? Then there's mourning. Grieving is a feeling you feel to express loss in life. But mourning is a decision you make to keep living with the loss. Okay? So grief is an emotion I feel. Everybody grieves. But mourning is a decision I make. Not everybody mourns. Notice the promise is not attached to those who grieve. It's attached to those who mourn. Because it's only as we choose to mourn, God meets us in our mourning and comforts us and encourages us and strengthens us and keeps us moving forward in life. If all we do is grieve and do not mourn, we get stuck in life. It's like when you go to a ball game or a concert or to an airport and go through one of those turnstiles. You got your ticket and you go through the turnstile and you get stuck. I like that. One more time. You get stuck. And every once in a while in life, if you live long enough, you'll get stuck. That's very frustrating for a person who's competent and wants to follow Christ and wants to seem to have it all under control and know where he's going and what he's doing. To get stuck is very confusing and quite perplexing. And I speak from experience. It was 9 years ago, I got stuck after my first wife's death. I got stuck. Grieving, grieving, grieving. 36 years, grieving, grieving, grieving. How do I go on? Grieving, grieving, grieving. Stuck. I was doing all the grieving. I was feeling sorry for myself, like I was the only person that ever lost a spouse. But I got stuck. And I couldn't get to the morning, to moving forward and living, because life is a river ever flowing forward. Life's going to go on without you, without me, without us. And yet, when I make the decision to take my grief and turn it into steps of faith, God meets me and he comforts me and he encourages me and he gives me the strength and the insight that I need through this blessing to live again, to experience life. And this woman right here in the front changed my life forever when she said, "Rob, there's a reason why the windshield is bigger than the rearview mirror." She said it so sweetly and so perfectly. And when she said it, it stayed said, because grief always looks backward. Always looks backward. Always. And there's a time for that. But if that's all you do, you get stuck. But mourning looks forward. Mourning says, okay, time to get up. Time to put on your big boy pants. Time to live. And here's what I found out. The only thing harder than not moving forward. Let me say that again. The only thing harder than moving forward is not moving forward. It's all hard, people, okay? It's all hard. Life is hard, okay? There's no magic formula here that's going to make it easier. You're going to get hurt. Things are going to happen. We're going to experience loss. But Jesus says, as you mourn, as you make the hard decision to move on, to keep living by faith, walking towards where he's leading you, as you do that, he says, I'll meet you there and I'll comfort you. I'll strengthen you, and I will promise you, you're going to make it, because you're part of the kingdom of heaven, there in verse 3. The blessing nobody wants, but the blessing everybody needs is appropriated as we move forward in spite of the losses of life. So in the kingdom of God, what do we have? Heaven straight ahead, and hope every step of the way. Father, intense message today, intensely personal, but intensely practical. And as we make it practical in our personal, it becomes intensely powerful. So I pray for my brothers and sisters this morning. I pray for their next step with you. Some of us may be in that low place right now, and it's a process, no doubt about it. we don't get it all in one step, but we can't get it all without the next step. So I pray for each person here to take that next step, whatever that may be, and I don't pretend to know, but that you will reassure them that it's okay to grieve, but at some point you got to mourn. It's okay to sit in a puddle, to sit in a pile of it, but at some point you got to get up and you got to walk. And as they do, as they trust you and take those next steps of faith, Father, I ask that you would meet them there and encourage them and empower them to be another living example of what it means to be part of your kingdom as we turn to you and trust in you. Father, we thank you that you give us victory in every situation, even those sad and sorrowful, deep and grieving times of life. And pray, God, that each one of us here today is part of the kingdom. We trust Jesus by faith, and we're walking with him day by day, rejoicing in all that he's doing, all he's providing, and helping others along the way who sometimes stop and stumble and wonder why. Help us to get our hearts and our ears and our eyes aware to those around us as well, who are wounded like us, who have been hurt in similar ways as we have, but now we're walking again. We're some better. We're in a position to help others through prayer and through listening and through encouragement. Help us to be part of the wounded healers as we move towards the day when all God's children get home. We thank you, Father. In Christ's name, amen. Now let's stand together. We have an invitation hymn. Maybe you'd like to receive Christ this morning. Maybe you'd like to become part of this fellowship. Maybe you'd like to take some other step of faith as God leads you. You come as we sing, softly and tenderly. To hurt, who wants to experience loss, who wants to go through pain? Not me. the blessing nobody wants. And yet, Jesus knew we would go through stuff like that. So he said, it's the blessing everybody needs. So take your hurts to him and your pains and your heartaches and heartbreaks, and don't be ashamed. Just go to him. Humble yourself and say, Lord, I hurt. I don't know why. Cry out to him. He'll find a way to help you, to comfort you, to encourage you. He's good like that. He's great like that. I've been encouraged by many people in this church for many years over many situations. What a blessing many of you are to me. I could call on many men here to close this in prayer. I hate to pick on just one because some of you have been just so fantastic. Every time I'm with guys, and little gals too, I'm not leaving you ladies out, but I'm going to just say there's been so many men. I go back to when I was a young guy, 21 years old in this church, out there with you. And the preacher would just go on and on. You think, are we going to, you know, we're done. But now here I am up here, and yet my needs, they're always being met through other people who God puts in my life. So I could mention a lot of people today, but I'm going to pick on one guy to close this in prayer who's been an encouragement to me for 40 plus years, and that's Pat Campbell. Pat, would you close this in prayer, please? Amen. God bless you all.